Gary Gerstle, historiador y académico estadounidense, nacido en 1954. Destacan sus libros Liberty and Coercion y American Crucible.
Seguimos en la cobertura especial de la Feria Internacional del Libro en Guadalajara y me da mucho gusto recibir a Gary Gerstle. Gary es profesor de la Universidad de Cambridge en el Reino Unido y ha publicado este libro recientemente traducido por el Fondo de Cultura Económica, Libertad y Coacción, la paradoja del gobierno estadounidense desde su fundación hasta el presente. Gary está presentando este libro, pero además va a participar en uno de los paneles de este coloquio que se está realizando aquí en la FIL de Guadalajara del tema del acoso de la civilización. Gary, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Well, let's start with your book. What is the argument of the book?
The argument tries to explain the contradictory attitudes that Americans have toward their own government. On the one hand, they have the sense that their freedom comes from being free of government. Get the government off my back. The New Hampshire license plate, which says live free or die. What is the freedom? It's a weird thing to have on a license plate. What is the freedom? The freedom is freedom from government. And this is deep in the American soul and deep in its DNA. And Americans, many Americans don't think they're free unless they're free of government, and this is part of the revolution against the British in the 18th century. On the other hand, Americans have not hesitated to legislate the most intimate and personal aspects of people's lives: who you can marry, who you can have sex with, whether you can drink or not, what kind of birth control you can use, whether or not you can have an abortion, whether or not you will be taught religion in public schools. So how, I wanted to know, can America have this ideology of being free of government and then legislate so thoroughly the way in which Americans live? And the key to that is the two levels of government in America. One is the central government, which is limited in its powers, is liberal in an 18th century sense of the term.
And you're talking central government is the federal government.
The federal government in Washington, D.C.
Okay.
This is constructed as limited, fragmented. There's a Bill of Rights that says an individual has rights that no government can touch under the most extreme circumstances. On the other hand, there are the state governments.
Yes.
New York, Georgia, all the others. And they are not bound by this theory of limited power. Their authority comes from actually the King of England. Somehow that authority jumps the revolution. This is the old regime in America, and it gives the states extraordinary power. So the central government is very limited in terms of what it can do. The states have extraordinary power to legislate the lives of Americans. And so Americans are always living, or have until recently, lived with this paradox: freedom from government, but state governments being able to say, if we want to treat you and handle you in a certain way, we can.
And what's the solution for this paradox? Because it seems to me that during the history of the United States, you have moments where you have more liberty and moments that you have more coercion. Is that right? I mean, it's like waves between the two values?
Yes. Well, one way of thinking about it is that the central government power grows and wanes, and state government grows and wanes. They are battling against each other. That's one way of thinking about it. Another way of thinking about it is the central government trying to be supreme and trying to break the power of the states and trying to bring the states under their conception of how government should operate. And the states are brought under the power of the central government only in the 1960s, in the midst of the Civil Rights Revolution. Because if you ask what are the states using their power for, one of the powers they're using it for is slavery. And after slavery, they're using it for segregation, to bar blacks from the rights that all of Americans have. And so in the 1960s, there's a campaign to reduce the power of the states, to say there must be liberty in the states as well as the central government. And so there's a turning point in the 1960s where the power of the states is broken by the federal government, and the federal government then begins to grow because it has to have more power to control the states.
And what was the decision during the 60s that broke the power of the state government?
It was a Supreme Court that begins to take shape under Roosevelt and the great reform of the 1930s. And these Supreme Court justices, known as the Warren Court under Chief Justice Earl Warren, this court says, we know that we're on thin ice when we're breaking the power of the states because their power comes from the Constitution, but we have this pressing issue in American society, the rights of African Americans, and the only way we can give African Americans their rights is to break the power of the states, and they come close to violating the Constitution in order to extend these rights. So it's the Supreme Court that's crucial.
It's the Supreme Court breaking the Jim Crow rules that, you know, made legal segregation in some states of America.
That's right. Until the federal government asserted itself and says, you can't do this, states were free to segregate if they so wished.
And also, you have like some controversial decisions like Roe versus Wade, no?
Absolutely.
Where the Supreme Court says, no, it's illegal for the state governments to ban abortion.
Yes, no? Until that time, states had the authority to ban abortions. They also had the authority to lay down laws about marriage and about whether a white person can marry a black person. Until the 1960s, more than 20 states barred racial intermarriage. It certainly could not happen. And here's something that's amazing that most Americans do not know, and that I did not know when I began this project. The Bill of Rights is known as a great achievement in America.
Yeah.
You have rights.
And in the world.
And in the world. It's one of the United States' great gifts to the world.
Yes.
It turns out the states were not bound by the Bill of Rights until the 1960s. The Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments to the Constitution were passed in 1791. Mm-hmm. It's not until the 1960s that this law becomes the law imposed on the states. And here the wording of the Constitution is crucial because the First Amendment says, Congress shall pass no law abridging freedom of speech, meaning federal Congress. So the courts interpreted that literally to mean the federal Congress shall pass no law restricting freedom of speech.
But the state
is not bound by that in any meaningful way. Mm-hmm. And so there's a volcano and upheaval in the 1960s in constitutional governments. It's an attempt to resolve the contradiction that had been in American government since the beginning. And it succeeds in the short term, but it arouses so much resentment among conservative Americans who think the Constitution has been violated that after the 1960s, struggle over what the proper use of government is or should be becomes in some ways the most important and controversial issue in all of American society.
Now, the 60s were very important in this regard, but you have a very liberal Supreme Court.
Yes.
No? The Warren Court was very liberal.
Yes.
But now it's changing, and now you have a very conservative Supreme Court. What would that mean for this tension between liberty and coercion?
Well, the current court, as you say, is very conservative. It is a backlash court. It is a court that took shape among conservatives because of what the liberal Warren court had done in the 1960s. It's a reactionary court, and they have the support of a lot of Americans who felt the Warren court went too far in terms of stretching the meaning of liberty. And the other matter that happened that concerns conservatives a great deal is, what did it mean for the federal government to conquer the states? It meant the central government could begin to grow in a manner which it had never grown before. And the Warren Court wanted this government to grow in a way that would help liberal causes.
Yes, absolutely.
But conservatives began to say, this growth of the central government is illegitimate and must be rolled back. And if you ask, what does the conservative court want to do today? It wants to remove government from the reform and management of the economy that earlier generations of liberals tried to implement.
But it's economy, or it's the other side, the values? Like, would you see the court banning again the abortion or or rolling back the equal marriage in some states. Would you see that?
It could, yeah. But not right now, because there are five conservatives on the court and four liberals. And the fifth conservative is a man by the name of Anthony Kennedy, who is deeply conservative in many ways. But he turns out to be a civil libertarian on social issues. And he has been the key vote on gay marriage. He'll probably be the key vote in terms of protecting rights of abortion. Turns out he's from California. And when he grew up as friends of the Warren family. Earl Warren was a California man. Yeah. And even though he was liberal, the two families knew each other. And Anthony Kennedy is like a sleeping, a sleeper, a kind of a... not someone who's regarded as a liberal, but has many of the liberal sentiments that were once so paramount in the Warren Court.
But the of course the risk is that if you have some of the justice, if some justice dies or retires from the liberal wing of the Supreme Court, then the conservatives are going to have the majority.
Yes. Anthony Kennedy, I think, is in his early 80s. They serve until they die or retire. There has been talk about his retirement.
Yeah.
If Trump gets this appointment,
it's
going to shift the Supreme Court profoundly in a conservative direction.
Now, let me turn to exactly to Trump, because you are going to speak about Trump and populism here in Guadalajara. Trump, what do... First, let me start by asking you, why did he win? What's your take on the election?
Part of the reason he won has to do with the story we've been talking about.
Mm-hmm.
This battle going back to the 1960s, where the power of the states is broken.
Mm-hmm.
There's a conservative counter-reaction, but the conservatives can never get enough power to really implement their agenda, not even on the court.
Yep.
And so what happens in America is a stalemate between liberals and Republicans, so that nothing is getting done. There is Congress is paralyzed.
Yeah.
Nothing is getting done. The last major piece of legislation passed by Congress was 2010, almost 10
years. Obamacare?
Not Obamacare. One issue after that about regulating Wall Street.
Okay.
But Obamacare was 2009. Regulating Wall Street was 2010. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Yeah.
For major legislation. A country of the size of the United States, of that complexity, with its population and its problems, Congress not being able to pass legislation. This is the origins of Congress becoming a swamp, profoundly connected to private interests, but unable to do its public duty.
Because you have a divided government. I mean, the president didn't have majority in both houses of Congress.
Yes, but it was also the bitterness of the divide between the Democrats and Republicans. So.
Yeah.
That's one reason. So paralysis, nothing getting done.
Mm.
And a lot of Americans said a plague on both your houses, even if we get an infidel or a heretic or a mad real estate developer, we're tired of what you're doing.
Mm.
Give us something different. So that's one element. The second element is the economic crisis of 2008, clearly a pivot point in world history. Before 2008, the gospel of globalization was neoliberalism,
and
the gospel of neoliberalism is that there would be no losers. Mexico would win and America would win from NAFTA. Rich people in America would win from NAFTA. Poor people would win. And I think what 2008 did, the economic crisis, it revealed that there were, in fact, winners and losers.
And losers.
And there were a lot of losers.
Yeah.
And Trump became brilliant at articulating the rage of the losers, many of them poor, white, working class Americans. And here we come to the third factor in this, which is that which is racial resentment.
Yeah.
And a sense that it's not just that white Americans were having a hard time, but my goodness, minorities were having it so good. A black man in the White House, Latinos taking American jobs. And so a sense that not only were white Americans, the true Americans, becoming poorer without opportunity, but oh my goodness, the country was being stolen because the people taking their place, taking their money, were non-white. And very important for a Mexican audience to understand that in the United States, Mexicans and Latinos are constructed as non-white or less than white, even if they are 100% Spanish blood, European descendant.
Yeah.
And so there's a sense of the final factor in propelling Trump forward is him saying to poor white Americans, I will give you your country back. I will bring jobs back, and I will send people of color away, and I will restore the proper order of things. And he was quite brilliant about articulating that sense of resentment and rage.
And of course, you also have the institution of the Electoral College. Mm-hmm. For us, it's very difficult to understand that, you know, that Hillary Clinton won the popular vote, but Trump won the election because of the Electoral College. And that is in relationship with your book, because the Electoral College gives an overweight, an overrepresentation to the small states.
Yes.
No, so it's part of the debate. No, I think it's an anachronism, the Electoral College. But I don't know what you think.
It
about
is absolutely that. An anachronism, and it points to it does go back to the issues framed in the book. And one of the key arguments in the book is that America is struggling with a constitution that was written a long time ago in the 18th century and in many respects is not suitable for life in the 21st century.
Absolutely.
And a lot of Americans think it's great to have the oldest written constitution in the world. My attitude is, in some respects it is, in other respects it's not.
Yeah.
Because things that you ought to be able to get rid of, like the Electoral College, cannot be gotten rid of. The Electoral College is part of the original Constitution.
Yeah.
And the Constitution of the United States is still an 18th century Constitution, has been amended very few times, cannot function adequately for the 21st century. There are a number of things America has to do in order to put its house in order. One of the things it has to do to put its house in order is to get rid of the Electoral College, but it can't do it. To amend the Constitution, you need 2/3 of each House of Congress.
Yeah, it's
and then you need 3/4 of the states.
Yeah.
And all the states, that means getting all the small states who are disproportionately valued by
it's
the Electoral College to give up their power.
Yeah.
They're not going to do it.
One last question. Populism in America, it's a long tradition, historical tradition. You always have these populist leaders. But this is the first time that you have a populist in the White House, I would say.
I think that's right. Some people think Andrew Jackson in the 1820s and 30s was the first, but I don't think he was a populist like Trump. Mm-hmm. Populists in America have profoundly affected politics in the past, but as pressure groups and they have never been elected to the presidency of the United States. So in that respect, this is a different moment. Now, populism in America is a little different from populism in Latin America, because populism in America was born as a democratic movement.
In the South?
In the South and in the Midwest. William Jennings Bryan, it was born as a quasi-socialist movement.
Yeah.
So there's a left populism and there's a right populism.
Mm-hmm.
And here you are more familiar with right populists, but there was not just a right populist in 2016.
Mm-hmm.
There was a left populist by the name of Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
And he began to describe himself as a socialist, but it's very hard to describe yourself as a socialist in the United States.
Yeah.
So many people who felt themselves to be socialists have historically called themselves populists. And 2016 is the election about populism in America on both the left
and the right.
And the right. And this is the key story, and it reflects deep, deep dissatisfaction in America with the status quo, with America's perceived declining power in the world, and with a government that simply does not seem to be working.
And what's going to happen? Just one more question. I know that we have to make a commercial break, but quickly, what do you foresee in America? Because it's very hard for me. I lived for 5 years in America, in New York, and it's very hard for me to imagine the United States as a populist country.
Well, and it's not clear. I don't think it will become a populist country. I don't think Trump is himself really a populist.
Yeah.
And in fact, in his administration now, it's neoliberalism that's winning out. It's under the surface. Part of what makes this moment so fascinating and terrifying is is so many things are possible, and we don't really know what's going to happen. The important element to focus on is the 2008 financial crash.
Okay.
And the neoliberal order fractured at that moment. The big question for our time is it going to fall, or is it going to repair itself?
Okay.
Both elements are present within the Trump administration. And,
yeah.
And today,
and you can see the tension.
You can see the tension. He's got Bannon and Steve Miller not Bannon anymore, but Steve Miller.
On the one hand.
On the one hand, he's got Gary Cohn representing Goldman Sachs and neoliberalism on the other.
Yeah.
Right now, neoliberalism is winning. But it's impossible to say month to month what he deeply believes in. I think he will serve out his term, mm-hmm. and I think the future will be determined both by the fight within the Republican Party between the populists and the neoliberals, and whether the Democratic Party is able to build on the Bernie Sanders insurgency, institutionalize it, and offer a credible alternative to neoliberalism. It's on that question that the future of America hangs.
Maybe Elizabeth Warren, I don't know, but anyway,
perhaps.
It's fascinating what's happening in the US. Of course, you now live in the UK, which is another discussion because many things are happening also in the United Kingdom. But Professor Russell, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. El libro La Libertad y Coerción, las paradojas del gobierno estadounidense desde su fundación hasta el presente, de Gary Gerstle, publicado por el Fondo de Cultura Económica. Muchas gracias por habernos acompañado. Yo lo espero mañana en punto a las 10 de la noche, cuando otra vez sea la hora de opinar. Mañana viernes concluimos con esta cobertura especial que le hemos traído desde la Feria Internacional del Libro en Guadalajara. Aquí nos vemos.